Hello, friends. Welcome back to another Tell It to the World Solid Ground podcast. So great to have you back with us today. And of course, I'm here with my friends, Jerby and Jared. How are you all doing today?
Doing great.
Awesome. Awesome. So friends, the last time we were together, as we were going through the series on religion, we touched on why there's so many religions in the world today, mm-hmm. right? We're going to dive deeper into that because we touched on Protestantism last time, but mm-hmm. we didn't go into too much depth.
No.
Today, we're going to dive into and mm-hmm. cover some of those Protestant churches and see if they align up to the Bible, mm-hmm. right? Because many today claim this and claim that. And we're going to analyze these Protestant churches in light of if they differ vastly from the Roman Catholic Church.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. Because Romanism, they also claim that they're Christians, right? Mm-hmm. So we're going to analyze them from the Bible and see what the Bible has to say. We mm-hmm. want the Bible to speak today, friends. Not us, but the Bible and the Bible alone. So mm-hmm. so let's get right into it without further ado, right? Who were Protestants historically?
Well, historically, Protestants was just a group of people who wanted to uncover the unbiblical things that the Catholic Church would push, as well as bring light to the abuses of the Catholic Church. And some of those people that we know of are very familiar names. We mm-hmm. have Martin Luther, there's mm-hmm. Zwingli, you have the Johns, where you have John Huss, you have John Calvin, John Knox. There's a lot of Johns.
Yeah, there is.
But basically, those are the main people that kind of like heralded this separation from the Catholic Church.
Right.
Okay, interesting. Yeah, I mean, again, a lot of Protestant reformers as we're going to go along and see. So how did all of these Protestant churches form or come to be about?
Yeah, you know, as we touched on before, during the Dark Ages or the Middle Ages, when the papacy, the Roman Catholic Church, was ruling the world, they also were forcing religion upon people. So they had the Bible held up, locked up. Many people couldn't read it, and if they did have access to it, they couldn't read it in that language.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, these reformers, they got the truth from God. God was opening their eyes, so they began to protest against those mm-hmm. errors. But as a result, once they made their separation from the Roman Catholic Church, their followers now only lived up to the light that their leader had,
mm-hmm.
whereas God was giving more and more truth. And as it were, these reformers were passing on the baton to the next one, but mm-hmm. their followers sort of stayed with just their teachings
mm-hmm.
and didn't advance with
from
the
there.
Truth. Mm-hmm. And so there you have all of these religions, not Protestants. Of course, we're talking about Protestants.
Right, yeah, yeah.
You have your Presbyterians,
mm-hmm.
right? Baptists,
mm-hmm.
Methodists, Lutherans,
mm-hmm.
all of these various denominations,
mm-hmm.
and the majority of them get their name from the leader they were following.
Okay, so with that said, you know, as we, even in the last podcast, we touched on God's true church based on Revelation chapter 12, right?
Mm-hmm.
That God's church today will have some identifying marks. But, you know, before we get into more of that, we're still talking about Protestantism, right? So what are some of the main principles that came from the Protestant Reformation, which, you know, many Protestants today claim to believe?
That's okay. Good question. Now, there are three main principles that Protestants they champion. They say,
mm-hmm.
this is what we believe. This is what we hold on to.
Mm-hmm.
Sola Scriptura. That's number one, which means that they believe in the Bible alone. This
mm-hmm.
is what they profess.
Mm-hmm.
Another one is Sola Gratia, which means grace alone. We are saved by grace, right? And then Sola Fides, faith alone. So they believe in Scripture alone, saved by grace alone, and mm-hmm. by faith alone.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. And you know, there was a lot of things that the Catholic Church would teach, well, basically going off of the saved by grace, saved by works.
Right.
And there's a lot of things that we know of today that the Catholic Church often pushes, which is number one being confessionals. You know, you're confessing your sins to another man,
mm-hmm.
another human being that has no right to know that, because mm-hmm. that's between you and God and you and the other person, whoever it may have involved.
And he's sinful too as well.
Exactly.
So you're confessing mm-hmm. your sins to another
sinful human being.
Yeah.
That's not going anywhere. Anywho. Mm-hmm. But anyway, aside from that, so basically what they're doing, they go into the confessional, and as they confess whatever sin it is that they commit, they receive some sort of work to go and go forward and do.
Mm-hmm.
So they say, okay, go ahead and do 3 Hail Marys since you stole a little piece of candy. Okay, go do 40 Hail Marys since you just cheated on your wife. You know, stuff like that. So they tell you, go do this many
mm-hmm.
of this specific prayer
mm-hmm.
in order to receive forgiveness for what you did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's interesting. And again, many of these things that we're talking about today, you can go back to the history books and find a lot of this information, history still there. You know, you just do a search, mm-hmm. and a lot of what, you know, happened in the past, even up until this point, you can find again in the history books. Mm-hmm. You know, and as we go along, you know, you guys just mentioned here that the Protestant churches believe in, you know, scripture alone, sola scriptura, right? So what doctrines now, I want to ask, do they hold that are unscriptural?
Well, number one, we can definitely say is baptism by sprinkling, and not by immersion, because biblically, okay, let's get into that, right? Okay, so there's a few churches that believe that you can be baptized by just receiving a small little sprinkle mm-hmm. of water, right? And even to the point in which they have some priests going around squirting people with water guns in order to baptize them.
In the Catholic Church.
In the Catholic Church, yes, the Catholic priests. Actually, let me read this article from CNN.com. It says, a priest fired holy water through a squirt gun at his congregants. Weeks later, he's gone viral. So we can see that they believe, you know, just squirt you with a squirt gun and you're baptized and you're saved, right?
So hold on, I want to ask a question then. So you're saying that there are some Protestant churches who, like the Catholic Church, believe that you can still sprinkle? Wow.
Yeah, and some of those churches are, let's read some of them off. There's the Lutherans, Methodists, Presbyterians, Anglicans, and even the Church of Nazarene. So those are the churches that actually believe that. Now, when we look at what the Bible teaches about baptism, we can look at the book of Matthew chapter 3. And when we read in Matthew chapter 3, it'll explain what happens when someone is baptized, the biblical definition of a baptism. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and, you know, that's when the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. So when we read this, it says that he came up out of the water. So if you come up out of something, what does that mean? You were inside.
You were underneath.
Underneath it. You were immersed in the water. So this is a biblical definition of baptism. So you're supposed to be immersed. Jesus didn't get sprinkled by John the Baptist. He got immersed into the water.
Amen. Right. Nor did John the Baptist squirt him with a gun.
No.
Jesus, no.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that's interesting, but clear from scripture there. Mm-hmm. Clear from scripture. Another doctrine that many of these Protestant churches hold on to as well is the secret rapture. That's a big one as well.
Huge.
That, you know, is permeating Christendom right now. And some churches that believe in this, you have the Baptist Church, the non-denominational, you know, believe it or not, and they you know, they go along with many things, non-denominational, Pentecostal as well, and even the Seventh-day Baptist. Now, don't get it confused with Seventh-day Adventist now. These are Seventh-day Baptists, right?
So what is the secret rapture theory? Well, I mean, what is it?
Well, it's actually taken from the book of Matthew chapter 24 and verse 37. Let's go there with us. Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, and look with us at verse 37. Let's start there. Verse 37. This is what the Bible says here. This is where many of these Protestant churches get this doctrine from, but it's out of context. 37, this is what the Bible says. It says, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Notice the context. It's in the days of Noah, painting a picture here. Let's go on. Verse 36. For as in the days
38.
Of Noah. Verse 38, rather. Apologize. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving into marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark. Still a context of the days of Noah, right? Verse 39. And knew not until the flood came and took them all away. So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Now it gives a parable, as it were, a metaphor. Then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, and one shall be taken and the other left. So this is where many of those Protestant churches get this idea of the secret rapture. One's going to be taken away secretly, and another's going to be left behind.
Hello?
Hi, Mom.
Chloe, welcome home.
So is everything set for Dad's surprise party?
He got called into work.
Can I buy you a coffee?
I'm waiting for someone. My dad.
Hi, sweetheart.
Hey.
Welcome aboard PanCon Flight 257 to London. Flight time today will be 6 hours and 30 minutes.
I love you.
People from all over this plane have simply vanished.
Chris, let me in! Chris!
Free me!
all want answers, and believe me, so do I, and I'll do my best to get them.
I heard some doctors talking. It's not just here. It's all over the world. One of these days, the
sky's gonna break. Chloe, are you okay?
Yeah, but Mom and Raimi, they're both gone.
He took them to protect them from the darkest time in the history of this world.
Looks like the end of the world. One of these days, the sky's gonna
break, and everything will escape. But notice how the Bible paints the picture and lets us know what context is it, as it was in the days of Noah, right? They were eating, drinking until the flood took them away. So who were taken away by the flood? That's the question.
That's the wicked.
It's the wicked that were taken. The Bible tells us that the wicked were taken away, right? While Noah, the other group, were preserved in the ark, right? So this idea of secretly being raptured away is not scriptural, scriptural, based on their definition and their foundational scripture. But notice what the Bible teaches in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 and 17. We're not not trying to make this a Bible study, but we want to show that many of these teachings and doctrines are not biblical. Right? They're not biblical, friends. And we want a thus saith the Lord. Notice what it says, 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 16 and 17, how it describes the coming of Jesus. It's not secret. For the Lord himself, this is talking of the second coming now, shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Verse 17, then we which are alive remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Now, is this secret if the Lord is coming with a shout?
No.
With the voice of the archangel? Is that
blowing a trumpet.
Is he tiptoeing?
That's
Christ,
letting everybody know.
Is Christ tiptoeing to earth, right? No, he's not, friends. No, he's not. That's Bible. Psalm 50, verse 3. Let's get another companion scripture. Who wants to read that for us?
I have it. It says, our God shall come and shall not keep silence. Ooh. A fire shall devour before him, and it shall be very tempestuous round about him. So he's going to come. It's not going to be silent. Tempestuous means it's going to be abrupt. It's going to be, you know,
there's
if you're in a tempestuous storm,
right?
Right? That's not quiet.
That doesn't not sound like secret to me. It sounds like Christ is coming, and everyone, you know, who beholds it shall, you know what I mean? They shall see Christ coming, and it's not going to be secret. And of course, you have another scripture in Matthew 24 and verse 27.
Plethora of scriptures.
It goes so on and on, right? It paints the picture of the context of Christ coming. It's not silent.
It's not silent.
It's not silent, friends. So again, this belief that you'll be secretly raptured away is not scriptural, friends. No. So we have to go back and study for ourselves to see what the Bible teaches, friends. Let us study to show ourselves approved, right? What's another doctrine that many of these Protestant churches hold on to that are unscriptural?
Well, a big one is that the law is done away with, meaning the Ten Commandments when people say that. The law is done away with. We are New Testament Christians, New Covenant Christians. We do not have to keep the Ten Commandments. And they get this theory from Colossians chapter 2, verse number 14 through verse 16. I'm going to read verse 14. It says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. They say, look, this is the commandments. Before I get there, what churches believe that the law was done away with? You have the non-denominational church, right? Which, again, they accept a lot of things because they claim, well, I'm not really a denomination. I believe in a lot of things. So you have also the Church of Christ and also the Presbyterian. And there are many others as well. I mean, we can't put them all here, but these are some churches which believe the law is done away with, right? But just really quickly, which handwriting of ordinances is Colossians 2 speaking of?
That's the real question.
That's the question.
Moses, right?
Friends, no, that's it. You said the answer. That's it. So, friends, we don't have time to break all of these down. There's so many doctrines here, but if you will go back and read, look at Deuteronomy chapter 31, verses 24 through verse 26, and you will see there that Moses was actually given some ordinances to write down in a book.
That's right.
He wrote it down with his hand, handwriting. This can't be speaking about God's law because God wrote it with his finger.
Right? Distinction, friends.
So again, Deuteronomy 31, verse 24 through 26, he wrote it, put it in a book, and put it in the side of the ark. Now, another point is, Colossians 2 says ordinances. Mm-hmm. When you study, trace that word throughout scripture, the ordinances, it points to the feast. Mm-hmm. You have your Passover, right? Mm-hmm. That was an ordinance. And all of the sanctuary services, killing a lamb, mm-hmm. all of these types that they had to do, mm-hmm. they were nailed to the cross because Christ had fulfilled them. Mm-hmm. Yes. That's it.
That's the point.
Exactly. So the Ten Commandments are still applicable for us today. We are to keep them.
And Jesus definitely came, and he said that he came to fulfill the law. Mm. So he's teaching Matthew us 5. How exactly to live them out. Mm-hmm. That's what Jesus's life was. Mm-hmm. And he's teaching us that on a daily basis, especially as we keep his commandments.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And when we think about it, when people say, oh, you don't need to keep the Ten Commandments anymore. Those were done away with. Okay, so going back to, I don't know if you said that recently, but you basically, when we were talking before the podcast, we were talking about how many say that, oh well, we just believe the last two commandments that Jesus said that everything stands upon by loving your neighbor loving exactly. So how exactly do you love your neighbor? What standard do you have in order to show what love is to your neighbor? That's the final six commandments, mm-hmm. in the latter six, where it says not to kill, and not to kill your neighbor. If you love them, you won't kill them. Mm-hmm. Not to steal from your neighbor, because if you love them, you want them to prosper as much as you. You don't want to take from them.
Right.
If you love them, you won't sleep with their wife. If you love them, you won't be hurting them. You'll basically be doing things in order to uplift them. Mm-hmm. So when you love someone, you're basically keeping the latter six of the commandments, because you're not wanting to hurt them or harm them in any way, mm-hmm. physically or mentally or spiritually.
Right,
so
right.
When people say that, so it's okay to kill people now because you're not keeping the Ten Commandments. It's mm-hmm. okay to steal now because you're not keeping you don't have to keep the Ten Commandments.
Nope. Yeah.
No.
That's what we have to dwell on. That's really it, mm-hmm. you know. And just going on, another doctrine that many of these Protestant churches hold on to is this idea of eternal torment. Mm-hmm. Right? When a person dies based on your good deeds, you go to eternal damnation, eternal hell, where you are burning forever.
Mm. That's
burning forever. Now that's a deep study in it of itself, right? Mm-hmm. Some of the churches that believe in this, you have the Church of Christ, mm-hmm. the Baptist Church, the Church of the Nazarene again, mm-hmm. and also even the Seventh-day Baptist, mm-hmm. right? They believe in this idea of eternal tormenting, where God is this judge and you are being burned forever. But what does the Bible teach about this? Again, we don't have the time to, you know, dive into all of that in this podcast. We want to show you just that, you know, in light of the Bible, mm-hmm. what is truth? What is truth? John 3:16, friends, tells us, for God so mm-hmm. loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whomsoever believeth on him shall not perish. Mm. Does that sound like God wants us to be perishing forever? Mm-hmm. Should not perish, but have everlasting life.
So who gets everlasting life?
Those who love God.
And believe in him.
And believe in him, right?
Exactly.
So those who are wicked, they're not going to receive eternal life in hell.
No.
It's only for the righteous.
Only for the righteous, friends. Only for the righteous.
Because they make God look so evil to say God's going to let you live forever just for you to burn forever.
Mm-hmm. No. Really? And we're also talking about Jonah as well, right? You had mentioned that. It was a very good example.
Right, because there are many scriptures. There's a few scriptures in the Bible when it talks about hell in that context mm-hmm. of it burning.
Burning forever, right?
Burning forever. Right. It may say the word forever. But friends, the way to understand the Bible is we have to compare scripture with scripture. Look at the context here and the context there. Mm-hmm. When we go to the book of Jonah, Jonah actually used this word forever. Mm-hmm. But it means until it is finished.
Mm-hmm. A certain
That's
time.
What it means.
Exactly.
Jonah 2 in verse number 6, it says, again, this is when he is in the belly of the fish. Mm-hmm. It says, I went down to the bottoms of the mountains. The earth with her bars was about me forever. Mm. Yet hast thou brought up my life from corruption, O Lord my God. Mm. So he says, I went down and the bars of, what does he say? The bars of, well, the earth with her bars was about me forever.
Mm-hmm. Now we know.
But was he down there in the fish's belly forever?
Jonah was not in the belly forever. No.
No. Until it was finished. That's what it means. So Malachi 4 verse 1 is another scripture. The wicked will burn up until they are finished burning.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
All right. And of course, you know, Malachi 4 and verse 1 lets us know that, you know, the day shall come. They shall burn as an oven. and all the proud, yea, and all that do weakly. Now, this is the second coming of, well, even the third coming of Christ, where he pours out judgment upon the wicked. After the millennia, he comes back and gives the reward to those who have been unfaithful, right? Mm-hmm. And this is the second death. Mm-hmm. And the scripture tells us in Malachi 4:1, they shall be as stubble, and the day that cometh shall burn them up, mm-hmm. saith the Lord of hosts, mm-hmm. that it shall leave them neither root nor branch. So if something's burnt up, if you're burnt up, that means you're not burning forever. There's a time period upon which you're burning mm-hmm. until it ends, mm-hmm. right? So the Bible lets us know this is not a forever burning, friends. And again, there's a plethora of scriptures that we can go through. Many. But this is not a Bible study, friends, right? Mm-hmm. We're not a Bible study, amen?
And another doctrine which Protestants believe in is that once you are saved, you're always saved. Once you give your life to Christ, that's it. You have non-denominational churches, they believe this. Baptists believe this. Pentecostals, Seventh-day Baptists believe this. And there are others. You know, all I have to do is give my life to Christ and I'm saved. But the Bible clearly teaches this is not the case. Mm-hmm. You know, there are scriptures to confirm this. But look at certain accounts of men in scripture. King Saul, right?
Yeah.
He once was saved. God called him to be king. But then look at his latter end. Mm-hmm. He was lost. Judas, he was a disciple with Christ. Mm-hmm. He was casting out devils. In that state, he was saved, mm-hmm. as it were.
Yeah.
But yet, he ended up betraying Christ. Mm-hmm. So you see examples of that in scripture. The Bible doesn't teach that. You can be, even Ezekiel talks mm-hmm. about, I believe, talks about the righteous man, that if he neglects his righteousness and goes into the ways of sin, mm-hmm. his righteousness shall be forgotten.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
So there's scriptures there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very powerful. Now, another doctrine that they teach is the belief of the immortality of the soul, basically meaning that once the person dies, that they're in heaven and they're watching you from heaven. Mm-hmm. And some of the churches that believe this are the Anglicans, non-denominationals. You have the Methodists, Seventh-day Baptists. You have Episcopalians, Presbyterians. There's a lot of them that believe this. So, mm-hmm. yeah.
Mm. So this idea here that the soul lives on after a person exactly. dies, is that biblical? What does the Bible teach on this subject here?
Well, the Bible says that once the person dies, your thoughts die with you. Everything mm-hmm. just passes away with you because mm-hmm. you no longer have understanding. You don't know anything that happens after you die.
All right. So let me pose this question here. Yeah. Let's go back to the basics now. What actually makes up a living soul?
Yes, that's a great question. We have to define what a soul is.
Right.
Exactly.
You know, they believe there's a living entity
yeah, exactly.
within you.
Yeah, yeah.
And then when you die, it just goes to heaven. But no, let's go to Genesis 2, verse 7. Mm-hmm. All right. It says, "And the Lord God formed man mm-hmm. of the dust of the ground." Mm-hmm. That's one. That's one element. "And breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Mm. So a soul is comprised of two elements, mm-hmm. the dust of the ground
and
the breath of life. Mm-hmm. mm-hmm. Any of these entities separate from one another does not constitute a soul.
Mm. So let me pose this question now. Let me inject this into there. What happens when a person dies now? You said those two elements, the dust mm-hmm. and the breath of life that God gives, right? Mm-hmm. They make up the living soul. So mm-hmm. what happens now when a person dies?
Mm-hmm. Well, in the book of Psalm, it compares death to a sleep. Mm-hmm. So basically the person is sleeping. Just like when you're sleeping, you're unconscious, you don't know anything that's happening around you. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing with those that pass away. They mm-hmm. have no knowledge of what's taking place around them. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And where many people get this idea that this soul lives on and goes to heaven, Ecclesiastes 12 and verse 7, it says, "Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was when you die, right? Mm-hmm. And the spirit shall return unto God who gave it." Mm-hmm. Somebody may say, "Oh, so there is a spirit that's living." No. What is this spirit? Notice that the language of Ecclesiastes 12 verse 7 mm-hmm. is the same language as Genesis 2 and verse 7. Mm. This spirit here, that word actually means breath. Mm. So there's not a living entity that goes back to God. No, it was breath that he gave to man. The breath just goes back to God. Mm. And Ecclesiastes 9 verse 5 says that the dead know nothing. Mm. Mm. So many scriptures here.
That's clear. Even Ezekiel 18 verse 20, the soul mm-hmm. that sinneth, it shall die, right?
That's it. So can souls die?
Of course they can die. And they're not roaming around, as mm-hmm. as we mentioned from here, from the Bible again, you know what I mean? And again, the crowning, this is actually where I wanted to get to, the crowning doctrine mm-hmm. that many of these Protestant churches,
the majority
hold on to, is the crowning act in this drama. It is Sunday sacredness,
yes.
right? Which we know from the scripture, which we're going to prove as well, that is unbiblical. And we're going to actually get the Catholics themselves to let us know, to tell us that this is unbiblical, this mm. idea of worshiping on the first day of the week, Sunday, right? So mm. what other denominations, what other Protestant churches hold on to this belief of Sunday sacredness?
We have Mormons, you have Lutherans, you have Episcopalians, you have Church of God, mm-hmm. Church of Christ, mm-hmm. you have Church of Nazarene, Pentecostals, a lot.
No. I mean, well, so Lutherans, just keep naming lot. Them. I mean,
majority, right?
The majority, Mormons, right, you know, right, right. Even Jehovah's Witnesses. Mm-hmm. I mean,
Sunday.
Practically all, almost all, I would say 90% of the Protestant denominations worship on Sunday. Obviously, so not
with
seven
the exception
day,
of the
Seventh-day Baptist, right. Seventh-day Adventist, and there are a few others, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. which may keep the Sabbath, but mm-hmm. most
I've
of them
even
hold
met
Sunday.
I've even met some non-denominational people mm-hmm. that keep the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. You know, recently, back when we were at the university, at the campus, mm-hmm. we met two young ladies that mm-hmm. actually keep the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. So that was interesting.
Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. So based on that, what does the Bible teach on this idea of Sunday sacredness? Is it in Scripture?
No.
It's not in Scripture. Let's go to the foundation. Mm-hmm. Genesis 2.
All right.
Go ahead. Genesis 2, verse 2 and 3.
Yes, Genesis 2, 2 and 3, which basically tells us, let us read it. It says here, and on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had made. Mm-hmm. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work, which God created and made. Mm. And this basically tells us that God chose a specific day, which is the seventh day, because mm-hmm. days 1 through 6, he worked, mm-hmm. he created, he made. And then on the seventh, what did it say that he did?
He rested.
He rested.
Mm. Now let's compare even Old Testament with New Testament, because right. people say, oh, well, that's Old Testament.
I'm a New Testament believer.
Exactly. All right. Well, let's take one more scripture from the Old to sum it up, mm-hmm. because, again, the Bible calls it the Sabbath, right? Mm-hmm. And, of course, it's in the commandments, Exodus mm-hmm. 20, verse 8 through 11. Mm-hmm. But Isaiah 58, verse number 13 tells us, if thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day. Mm. So this Sabbath, the seventh day Sabbath, is the only day in Scripture God calls his holy day. Mm. All right, that's Old Testament. Let's take New Testament.
All right.
You can go to Luke chapter 4, right? Mm. In Luke chapter 4, Jesus went to the synagogue. It says, as his custom was. This is verse number 16. Jesus went there as his custom was on the Sabbath day. Take Acts 13. Read Acts 13. You have verse 14, verse 27, verse 42, verse 44. Paul is worshiping on the Sabbath day. Yep. Mm,
that's interesting.
Many references.
Right.
Yes. And there is one scripture as well where people say, well, they had a meeting
on Sunday.
Right? On the first day of the week. Now, when you study out that account there carefully, friends, it is still pointing to that it was a Sabbath evening meeting, mm-hmm. which ran into that early morning on Sunday.
Mm-hmm. And biblically, mm-hmm. you know, a day begins in the evening time when the sun mm-hmm. sets, a new day begins mm-hmm. scripturally.
Because right? in Genesis, it says the right? evening and the morning were the
first day.
You know, from what we've covered so far, it looks like many of these Protestant churches so claim that they share, you know, they have more in common with the Catholic Church than, mm-hmm. you know, than they say. Mm-hmm. In essence, because again, we covered what a Protestant is and churches. Who they were, you know, they protested against the errors mm-hmm. of the Roman Catholic Church. Yes. But many of them still seem to share many of those doctrines of the Roman Catholic Church.
Yeah, and not only that, but they profess to believe in Scripture alone. Mm-hmm. But even if they have some beliefs that differ from the Catholics, can you find it in Scripture? That's the point. Otherwise, you're not Protestant.
If you can't find it in the Bible, you are not a Protestant. So I want to go back to this idea of the immortality of the soul, right? Mm-hmm. That was one of the main central doctrines, even Sunday sacredness, sacredness that the Protestants have in common with the Roman Catholic Church. That's
two.
The link. That's the mm-hmm. link right there. So, you know, just moving a little bit away from the Protestant, do the Roman Catholics believe in this idea of the immortality of the soul, that when a person dies, mm-hmm. they live on, their soul is in heaven?
Mm-hmm. Still today. You can see with the saints. Go ahead.
Yes, that's definitely the first thing with the saints, because why would you pray to someone that can't hear you? So mm-hmm. basically, they believe that Mother Mary can still hear you. Mm-hmm. They believe that Mother Teresa can hear you. They mm-hmm. believe that all of these saints, this, that, and the third, that they can still hear you. So for mm-hmm. that reason, you bring your specific petitions to them and then they can hear you. And when we think about it, there's actually this clip of this little boy that was talking to Pope Francis and wanted to find out if his dad was in heaven. Mm-hmm. So we'll let you guys take a look at that clip real quick.
Dai. Vieni da me, Emanuele. Io ho chiesto permesso a Emanuele di dire in pubblico la domanda e lui mi ha detto di sì, per questo la dirò. Poco tempo fa è venuto a mancare mio papà. E lui era ateo, ma ci ha fatto battezzare a tutti e quattro figli. E era un uomo bravo. E in cielo, papà? Com'è? Cosa vi sembra a voi? Un cuore di papà. Dio ha un cuore di papà. E davanti a un papà, che non credente, è stato capace di battezzare i figli e di darle quella bravura ai figli. Voi pensate che Dio sarebbe capace di lasciarlo lontano da te? Pensate quello? Ma forte, con coraggio. Dio abbandona i suoi figli? Dio abbandona i suoi figli quando sono bravi? Ecco, Emanuele, questa è la risposta. Dio sicuramente era fiero di tuo papà, perché è più facile, essendo credente, battezzare i figli che essendo non credente battezzarlo. E sicuramente a Dio questo è piaciuto tanto. Parla con tuo papà. Prega tuo papà.
So basically he said that since your dad was a good man, he got you guys baptized without him really believing mm-hmm. in being baptized himself. Mm-hmm. Why would God say that he's a bad man? Mm-hmm. He wanted you guys to be raised in Christ. But he didn't really answer the question right. if he was in heaven, but he still said, pray to your dad.
That's it. Mm-hmm. Pray to him.
How can I pray to someone who's dead?
How can a man who lived on earth with me, who was also a sinner, mm-hmm. how can I pray to him? Mm-hmm. And he's dead.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now we covered from scripture that soul that when it dies,
it shall die,
right? The soul mm-hmm. that sinneth, it shall die. And his soul went back to God. The,
mm-hmm. His breath
back to God, right? So how can you pray to the Father? And notice what the Pope also said, that, you know, doesn't God still look at him as a good man? Mm. Mm. He did these good things even though he wasn't a believer.
There we go. Back right? to works.
John 3:16. What does John 3:16 say though?
Hey, for God so loved the world.
That whosoever believeth yes. on him shall not perish.
So
right?
those who believe in him are the ones that God does not want to perish.
And you know, we want to give a disclaimer here to qualify mm-hmm. these statements again. We're not saying that we are the judge of this boy or his father, mm-hmm. right? Only God can judge his heart. We don't know. Right, mm-hmm. we're only teaching and sharing what the Bible says, mm-hmm. not our words, but what God's word teaches. Yes. But ultimately, at the end of the day, God has the final say
exactly.
on an individual where they end up.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right. So as we go on here, I want to bring back the Protestants into this conversation, still touching on and talking about this idea of Sunday sacredness. Right. Where did these Protestants get the idea, get the teaching of worshiping on Sunday in order to keep it holy?
Hmm. Well, briefly, we saw it's not in scripture.
No. Right, okay, it's not there.
And these Protestants, they have broken off from the Catholic Church, mm-hmm. but are they still attached in some way? Hmm. Let's go to the Convert's Catechism of Catholic Doctrine. This is right. a book of the Roman Catholic faith, mm-hmm. which they share with people to be converted to the Catholic Church. Let's see what they say is the Sabbath day.
Page right. 49 and 50. I remember right. it because we go to it all the time all to right. show people.
So they're from their words. Okay.
Page 50, it says, which is the Sabbath day? Answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Hmm. They said it, right? Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday.
Hmm. Are we reading that right? Hmm. It says the Catholic Church transferred, not God.
Mm. No, not God. The church.
The Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. And the Bible prophesied that this would happen, Daniel 7 and verse 25, that the papacy would think to change times and laws. God's times, God's laws.
Yep. Mm, Daniel 7, 25, interesting, yeah.
So we're seeing it right here. So when Protestants honor Sunday, they are not honoring the Bible, not sola scriptura, but the traditions of the Roman Catholic Church.
Whenever you show that to people, they're just mind blown. They're like, what? I did not know this.
Yeah.
And it's just amazing to me to see that someone thinks that you can really go above God's word. And it's not only the Catholic Church that does this, because many people today just take the Bible and take whatever words it is that they want to and just transform it into something completely different and share a completely erroneous thought and say, hey, the Bible says it. So we see all of these things.
That's right. You know what that shows me? It shows me that I must know what I believe.
Yes.
I must be studying the Bible for myself.
For myself.
Because many people in the Catholic Church are sincere,
right?
They may not know that these articles, that these beliefs are there, right? And they're just following blindly, unfortunately, right? But that shows each one of us, even those viewing right now, that we have to study the Bible for ourselves. Know what the Word of God says, right? And again, you know, there might be many sincere Protestants in some of these churches as well. We're not lambasting these people, right? They may be ignorant, but God is calling us back to the Bible truth, right? That's God's true religion here, Bible truth, friends. Mm-hmm. Let's take another witness. Where this idea of Sunday sacredness came from. Notice this is from the Catholic Mirror, the Catholic themselves, friend, not our words. Mm-mm. This is from Cardinal Gibbons from the Catholic Mirror, September 2nd, also December 23rd, 1893. It says this, the Adventists, he now specifies a group of individuals now, right? The Adventists, quote, are the only body of Christians with the Bible as their teacher, who can find no warrant in its pages for the change of day from the 7th to the 1st. Now, this is a Catholic cardinal now, calling out the Adventists and saying, these individuals are the only group of individuals that have the Bible as their teacher. Mm-hmm. That speaks volumes, friends.
Yeah.
Notice he goes on. He says, reason and common sense demand the acceptance of one or the other of these alternatives, either Protestantism and the keeping holy of Saturday, which is biblical, or Catholicity, or you see Catholicity, Kala. I'm gonna say Catholicism, right? But he says Kala. Catholicity.
You said it right the first
time. Yeah, you said it right the first time.
Catholicity. Don't mind my English here, friends. Catholicity, he quotes it, Catholicity, and the keeping holy of Sunday. Compromise is impossible. I leave that there. That speaks without any explanation, friends. Any explanation.
Clear cut to
any
the
explanation. He says that the Sabbath is biblical, but Sunday, you can't find it.
Wow.
You can't find it.
And so you're saying that even though they say Easter Sunday, Jesus resurrected, that's why we worship on Sunday. That's not a reason?
That's not a valid reason.
Even though the apostles, they worshiped on Sunday too, that's not a reason?
Well, you have to realize the context.
Right, they broke bread, you know, daily, but they worship on the Sabbath day.
Worship.
They never kept Sunday as holy.
Exactly. Yep. So again, right there from the as they say, the horse's mouth, right? Mm-hmm. In the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established, friends. Yep. We leave it there, right? So as we transition, by holding on to some of these doctrines, you know, that these churches fall into, which is, again, is this false system of worship, Sunday sacredness. It's not biblical, right? It brings my mind to Revelation chapter 17, rather. 17. Right? What is brought to view?
Well, there's brought to view a woman, which represents a church, and she's riding on a beast. And as you study the symbols here, it's pointing to the Roman Catholic Church. Look at verse number 4.
Okay.
It says that this woman, which represents a church, is arrayed in purple and scarlet. Mm. What church has as their official colors red and purple? The Roman Catholic Church, right? Mm-hmm. Then it says in verse number 5, she's called Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Mm. What church claims to be the mother of all churches?
The Catholic Church.
The Roman
Catholic Church.
How can we confirm this? Verse 6, it says that she was drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. What church historically has killed God's saints and martyred millions.
This is the Roman Catholic
an
Church.
An innumerable number. Mm. Yep. The Roman Catholic Church, right?
That's right.
So we see here, but it says in verse 5, she's the mother of harlots.
Mm.
Harlots. And she's called Babylon.
If harlots. She's a, if she's a mother, that means she has daughters, right?
Daughters.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And who are the daughters?
These churches who mm-hmm. still hold on to erroneous doctrines. Yes. From the Catholic Church, which cannot be proven in Scripture.
Exactly. Mm, mm.
That's very interesting. Wow. Again, from the Bible, and Revelation 12 brought to view that pure woman.
Mm-hmm.
But Revelation 17 is not a pure church,
impure
not a pure
woman.
So there's the connection right mm-hmm. there. Interesting. Now, you know, as we go along, there's this prominent minister by the name of T.D. Jakes. We're very familiar mm-hmm. with T.D. Jakes,
yep,
right?
Familiar with
and this idea here, this doctrine of, you know, worshiping on Sunday. He believes that you can, you know, not only worship on Sunday, but you can worship any day of the week, right? And we mentioned from Scripture that God specified a day in which his people are to worship him, right? We're not saying that you cannot give glory to God any day of the week, but God specified which day, right?
To set aside
as holy. Set aside as holy. Amen. Amen. So let's play that clip of T.D. Jakes so you can get a context of what some of these prominent churches in Protestantism believe today.
Now, I grew up in the Baptist church, and a very traditional Baptist church at that, and I grew up going to Sunday school and vacation Bible school, and when I went to vacation Bible school and Sunday school, they taught me about the Sabbath day, and there was a great debate going on at that time as to what day was the real day to worship God. That debate continues to this day and has existed all the way back to the Old Testament theology as to what is the right day to worship God. In spite of the fact that the New Testament tells us not to give respect of days, we're still debating over what day we ought to worship. I had run into some good friends as a young man that were Seventh-day Adventists, and I still have a lot of friends who worship the Lord on Saturday, which technically is the Sabbath day. And there was a great deal of debate going on with them as to what was the right day to worship God. I have absolutely no problem with anybody who chooses to go to church on Saturday. I have no problem with that. I would never debate that. I would never argue about it. I can pass by the Seventh-day Adventist church and wave and respect and appreciate their right to worship on Saturday, probably because I also worship on Saturday. Yeah, I do. I hope that does not exempt me from an opportunity to serve as your pastor, but I worship on Saturday. I always, ever since I've been saved, I've worshiped on Saturday and Friday and Thursday and generally on Wednesday too and Tuesday and Monday as well and Sunday.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
What say you?
He made light of it.
Mm.
He did. He said, you know, I have some friends that worship on Saturday. Mm. I could go to a Seventh-day Adventist church and just, you know, respect them.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I worship on Saturday, too. I hope that doesn't make me less of a good preacher. You know, like,
mm-hmm.
what?
Mm-hmm.
I worship on Saturday, too. I worship on Sunday, too, and Monday and Tuesday mm-hmm. and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday. Mm-hmm. You know, but God specified a day. God gave us a specific day to worship him on.
Mm-hmm.
He said, these 6 days I labored, I worked, I toiled. But on this day, this is a special day to me because this is the day that I can spend time with you.
Mm-hmm.
Because all this time I was preparing for you, but now I want to spend time with you.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people might say, well, you know, there it is right there. You know, it doesn't really matter the day in which I worship. Because he quotes from Scripture, right? Colossians mm-hmm. 2, verse 14 through 16. Mm-hmm. I think verse 16
yep.
he quotes, right? Let no man
judge you. Meat or drink or respect of a holy day.
A holy day. What's going on here?
I mean, again, when you study that out, the context of it is speaking about the sanctuary services of the Old Testament,
mm-hmm.
right? Because they had holy days, ceremonial Sabbaths
mm-hmm.
that they were to keep in connection with the sanctuary and the ordinances,
mm-hmm.
which were your feasts, your Passover, these specific things they had to do.
Mm-hmm.
But since Christ came and died on the cross, even is resurrected and now is in heaven, those things we don't have to keep. Are we slaying lambs?
No.
Every time we
not that I know
sin?
Of.
No, we pray directly to Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Do we have to keep literally the Passover feasts?
Mm-mm.
No, we don't have to do those things.
All
so
those things were representing what Christ would do
exactly.
when he came.
They were symbols. And so those are done away. But the Sabbath
mm-hmm.
is not done away. The mm-hmm. best way to explain this is like a marriage, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Richard, you're married, right?
Yes, right.
But you got married on a certain date.
Yes.
Now, every time that date comes around, it's a very special day. Isn't that right?
Absolutely. But it's a memorial, as it were.
Exactly. But do you only love your wife
on that day?
Do you only show her affection and attention on that day?
No.
Every day, right?
Every day.
So that's how it is with Christ. Yes, T.D. Jakes and others, we are to worship God. To be in an attitude of worship Sunday through Saturday. But Saturday is the day we stop all our work.
Exactly.
Set aside, spend that quality time with God.
He's top priority.
Exactly.
That's our anniversary day with God.
Yes. Amen.
That's it.
Every week.
And then what
not just once a year.
Not just once a year. Every
Ezekiel
week.
Ezekiel 20, verse 12, it says that, moreover, also I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctify them. So it shows that this Sabbath is a sign between him and them. Who's them? Those that want to worship him, because they understand that this is a day of memorial, because God created us and he wanted this day as a time to rest, so we can all conjoin together, so we can all worship him in truth, because this is the day that proves that these are my people.
If you love me,
keep my commandments.
Keep my commandments, right? And that's John is in the New Testament. So lest a person say, well, I'm a New Testament keeper. I only believe in the new covenant, as it were. The Bible lets us know right there, friends, that God still upholds. God still wants us to uphold the law, right?
Yes.
And the thing is, he writes the law in the heart. He writes the commandment in the heart. Hebrews 10, verse 16, and Hebrews 8, right? I will write my law in your heart. I will, you know, and that law includes which commandment?
The fourth.
All of them.
And the fourth is linked to what day?
The Sabbath day.
The Sabbath day.
As we now commonly call it Saturday.
So is it done away with?
Nope.
If God writes it, can
with
it be
his finger in stone.
Oh, right, friends. All right. So as we sum this all up, as we come to a close here, you know, many think that, you know, just because I profess to be, you know, a follower of Christ, just because I profess to be a Protestant, means that I'm saved by default. As we have gone through this podcast here and touched on a few things, you know, it shows us that, you know, that hey, I have to uphold all of the Bible truth, right? Not by tradition. Not by the works of or words of man, not by works alone can I be saved, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God, right? And a very prominent minister in the Lutheran Church, Tony Palmer, you know, who had professed to be a Protestant, right? Protesting the doctrines of the Roman Catholic Church. This is what he says in a clip, friends.
Brothers and sisters, Luther's protest is over. It's yours. There's a challenge for you. So the protest has been over for 15 years. And I get a bit cheeky here because I challenge my Protestant pastor friends. If there is no more protest, how can there be a Protestant church? Maybe we're all Catholics again.
So Tony Palmer said that the protest is over. Now, is the protest truly over for Bible-believing Christians?
No, not for me.
What say you?
Not for me.
Your protest is over?
No.
Still going to protest by God's grace.
Still protesting.
And again, this protesting is not going in the streets and rioting and attacking the Roman Catholic Church. Let's get it right.
That's not
the true protest is upholding Bible doctrines, living it, and sharing it with others so that they will not be deceived by erroneous man-made traditions. That's
exactly
the true protest.
That's it.
Yes, and actually, let me read to you guys this, just a little snippet from this quote from Great Controversy, page 148, paragraph 4. It says, the Reformation did not, as many suppose, end with Luther. It's to be continued to the close of this world's history. Did it end with Luther?
Nope.
No,
it doesn't.
The baton has been passed down.
The proverbial baton.
Yes, thank you. That's it. The proverbial baton has been passed down through the ages. And we are to all carry that truth to other people so that they can understand that the protest still lives today. And we're upholding the Bible standards.
Amen.
Everything that the Bible says, we believe.
Amen.
And we stand by it because it's God's word and he created us and we trust him.
Amen.
And as we have covered before in a previous podcast, it is the Seventh-day Adventist message, that movement which God has given the truth for this time. And to go along with your quotation there, Revelation 12 and verse 17 shows us that the protest has not and will not end until the coming of Jesus Christ. It says this, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which do what? keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Mm. So the devil knows the true protest is not over. Mm. He's wroth. He's looking for that group of people, but I want to be in that number, abiding by the true principles of God's word so that I may continue this protest. And again, the protest is calling people out of false systems of worship into God's true worship.
Amen. By your testimony as well. Yeah. Mm. More specifically, by your testimony. Don't go Bible bashing people, say, hey, the Bible said this. And the Bible said, like, no, because I was not drawn in that way. Yeah. And I certainly will tell you, if somebody did that to me, I would have been out. Mm. But God lured me in with love. Mm. So in the same way, we should also do that with others. Share with them in love. You know, I once believed that Sunday was a day of worship, but once I studied this scripture and comparison with this scripture, that's when I understood that this is actually the day God wants me to worship on Saturday, not Sunday. Did you know that? And then share with them the facts that you understand, because the Bible says, with everlasting love have I drawn thee. That's the same way we're to reach others.
That's beautiful. One last thing I would just say, you know, on that point, as we're evangelizing with others, don't be so quick to just attack the most controversial points of doctrine, the differences between your religion and theirs. But find the commonalities as well, and then as God leads you, as you build that relationship, then he will lead you how to introduce some other things. And just as you share, that was beautifully said, you know, with your testimony and saying, as I study, as I was comparing scripture with scripture, this is what I found. What do you think based upon the word of God, not my opinion?
Amen. And with that, I couldn't have said it any better myself, friends. So if you're listening to this podcast hereafter and have questions and concerns, please reach out to us, you know, with your questions, you know, on some of these subjects. Even if you're not part of the Seventh-day Adventist movement or church, reach out to us. You know, is this biblical? You know, we want to hear from you. We want to know, again, we want to stand upon the principles of the Bible, friends. We don't go by tradition or what man says, but we want to hear, what does God say? The Almighty God, what does his word say, friends? That's why we want to, that's what we want to live by, right? So reach out to us at our email, TITTW@savedtoserveministry.com. And again, those of you who have come into this truth, right? We're not only speaking to those who are not a part of this denomination, but how did God bring you into the Seventh-day Adventist truth, the denomination, the movement here? Share with us your testimony. Send us those emails. Even comment below in the comment box below and let us know how God has been working upon your heart and how he has brought you into the truth, friend. Share your testimony, all right? So, but until then, thank you for joining us on this Solid Ground podcast. I hope you were blessed and encouraged to go forth and to evangelize, friends. Don't forget to like, to subscribe to our channel, to share this video with your friends and your family. And of course, we will see you next time on Solid Ground. So God bless and Maranatha.